Dear friend, I am Dr. Arvind Chauhan, Assistant Professor and Head, Department of Zoology, Digambar Aurobindo Arts, Commerce and Science College, Bhopal. And in today's lecture, our video lecture, we are going to discuss about the type of the behavior. Dear friend, before starting today's lecture, I would like to invite you all to subscribe and like my YouTube channel, as well as the press bell icon for the more update of my video. Dear friend, in last video lecture, we have learned about the introductory part of the animal behavior, in which we have briefed out the different types of the behavior, that innate behavior as well as the learned behavior, along with the some behavior kinds. Those are the mostly innate behavior or the mostly learned behavior or the partially innate behavior or the partially learned behavior or partially learned behavior only. So these three different types we have discussed in the last lecture. So in today we are going to discuss about the types of the behavior. Basically, there are two types of the behavior. One is the innate behavior, or we can say it as the stereotype behavior, and another is a learned behavior. So firstly, we overlook or discuss about the innate behavior. Basically, innate behavior, in which we learn about the behavior that are pre-programmed into an animal, genes, including reflex, taxis, kinesis, and the fixed action pattern. While in case of the learned behavior, we have to be focused on the habituations, imprinting, classical conditioning, operant conditioning, and the consecutive learnings. These are the types of the different both innate and the learned behavior. So firstly, we will overlook over the innate behavior. So dear friend, innate behavior is the behavior that, as we know, as per our previous lecture, it is a genetically hardwired in an organism gene, or we can see it as a stereotype behavior, and can be performed in response to a clue without a prior experiences. Reflex action, such as the knee jerk reflex tested by a doctor and sucking reflex of the human infants, are a very simple innate behavior. Okay, so some organism perform innate kinesis, undirected change in the movement, and taxis, that is a directed change in the movement. The behavior against the response of an stimuli. While in some action, some of the animal, we have seen the fixed action pattern consisting of series of action triggered by a key stimuli. The pattern will be go completion even if the stimuli is removed. To this, the scientists can test if the behavior is innate by providing the stimuli to the untrained animals. Yes, and to see if the behavior is automatically triggered or not. So to this, if we watch a herring bull caring for its chick or young one, we may notice a funny ritual around the feeding times. The parent bull has a red spot on its beak. When it taps its beak on the ground, the chick will peek at the spot several times. This peeking triggers a response in the parent. It throws up the food for the chick or their young ones. That may sound goose to us, but to the herring bull chick, it is like a pizza dinner. Yeah, as we shown in the figure, in the photograph, there were the bull chicks, they are feeding their young one. And one photograph showing that there was a bull chick having a red spot on their beak. So this tapping behavior is innate or genetically programmed. Herring bull chick will peek at the red dot of their parent beak without any prior training. In fact, a baby herring bull can be tricked by a yellow stick adorned with the red dot. It will be peek at the stick just as angrily as it would be a parent beak. This is just one example of an innate behavior or behavior that is genetically hardwired in an organism. Giving the right clue, an organism will perform an innate behavior without any need of prior experience or learning. Innate behavior tend to be very predictable, like the herring bull type, and they are often performed in a very similar way by all the members of the species. So in today's lecture, we will see example of behavior that are largely or fully innate, keeping in the mind though that many behavior in the real world are partially innate or partially learned. If we take the example of zebra fish, they are the program to learn a song, but which song they learn depend upon their early life experiences. Yeah, so now we are going to move toward the one of the kind of our innate behavior, that is the reflex. So the reflex, perhaps the simplest example of an innate behavior is the reflex action, an involuntary and rapid response to a stimuli or a clue. One example of the human reflex action is the knee jerk reflex. To test this, doctor tapped the tendon below the knee cap with a rubber hammer, and the tapping activated the nearby neuron, causing our lower legs to tick involuntarily. And this automatic response depends upon circuit of the neuron that runs in between the knee and the spinal cord, and it doesn't involve our brain. So how do this reaction or jerking of our legs that is activated or occurs, and what is responsible for that? So if we see that that our quadriceps muscles of our thigh, they are stretched. There is a stretch receptor neuron that is activated when our patellar tendons get tapped, and this stretch receptor neuron send a signal to two other neurons in the spinal cord. One is the motor neuron and another is the inhibitory neuron. This motor neuron muscle controlling neuron that travel back to the quadriceps, this neuron is activated by the stretch receptor neuron and cause the quadriceps muscle to contract. The other neuron is an inhibitory neuron which link up to a motor neuron controlling the hamstring muscle on the back of our thigh. Okay, so when it activated, the inhibitory neuron preventing the hamstring muscle for contracting, ensuring that it does not oppose the quadriceps muscles. Okay, so this is about the reflexes. Some other example of the reflexes are present in the human babies, but are lost or placed under conscious control as the baby grow older. A newborn baby will suck at any time that touches the roof of its mouth. This reflex helps the baby to get food by ensuring it will be sucked at the mother breast or the bottle placed in its mouth. Okay, so this is all about the reflex. Now another type of the innate behavior, that is kinesis or the taxis. So what is meant by kinesis or taxis? So kinesis or taxis, these are the innate behavior in which the organism change their movement in response to a particular clue, or the you can say it as a stimuli. Either it may be a high temperature or taste of the food or food source. In case of the kinesis, an organism changes its movement in a non-directional way. For example, if we take an example of either speeding up or the slowing down in response to a particular goo. If we take the example of wood lice move faster in response to the temperature that are the higher or the lower than their pupil stage. The movement is random, but the higher speed increases the chance of that wood louse will make it away out of the bad environment. Okay, so in case of the taxis is the form of movement behavior that involve movement toward or away from the stimuli. This movement can be response to a light known as the phototaxis. Either it may be a chemical signal, then it is called as the chemotaxis. It may be known as the gravity, or known as we can say it as a geotax among the stimuli. It can also be directed toward or away. When it is directed toward, then we can see it as a positive chemotax or positive taxis, or when it is away from the source of stimuli, then we can see it as a negative. right? If we have taken again the example of the wood lice shows the negative phototaxis, meaning that they will move away from the source of light. And this behavior may be helped because wood lice required a moisture environment and a sunny light spot is more likely to be warmer and drier. Right? So we can see another example of the chemotaxis, either positive or the negative chemotaxis. In case of the if we take the example of the positive chemotaxis, come from the single cell protozoan, that is the Tetrahydronoma thermophili. This is an organism swimming in swimming by using the hair like procession called as cilia. At the time of moving in the straight line and at other timing making turn, when it sends an attractive chemical, Tetrahydronoma decreases the frequency of its turn. The turn get rarer and rarer as the concentration of the chemical increases, and this pattern make the macros move in an increasingly straight line up to the concentration gradient of the chemical towards its sources. Now question arises that are these taxis or the kinesis are always innate? So question answer to this question, it is not necessary. In many more complex organism, kinesis and taxis may be learned or may have both learned and the innate component. The strength of the taxis behavior may be modified by the experience. Let's look at the one of the example that behavior or functionally behavior that is the functionally a taxis but clearly not an innate behavior. Do you tend to move toward the kitchen when you smell and your favorite dish is cooking in the kitchen? That is the positive chemotaxis. Whenever we smell out our favorite dish and we move toward the kitchens, that the positive chemotaxis is a sense, but it is probably not handwired in our chin. Okay, so I hope that you will understand the taxis and the chemotaxis with this simplest example of these. Okay, so now we will move toward another type of the innate behavior, that is we can say it has a fixed action pattern. It is a predictable series of action triggered by a clue or stimuli. Sometimes it is called the key stimulus. Though the fixed action pattern is more complex than a reflex, it is still automatically and involuntary. Once triggered, it will be go on to the completion, even if the key stimuli is removed in the meantime. So we already saw one example of the fixed action pattern in the introductory part of this today's video lecture. A spotted pig behavior in herring gulls. Let's look at the couple of other examples that show how the fixed action pattern is work. Okay, so we have one of this case study about the egret travels, which shown in grey like this. A well studied example of fixed action patterns occur in a ground nesting water bird like grey like geese. If a female grey like geese egg roll out of her nest, she will instinctively use her bill to push the egg back into the nest in a series of very stereotypic predictable movement. And the sight of an egg outside the nest is the stimulus that trigger the retrieval behavior. It's not too hard to imagine why this handwired trait would be favored by a natural selection. Goose mothers that retrieve their lost egg are likely to have more surviving offspring on average than those don't. However, this fixed action pattern can also occur under circumstances where it is not useful, in other words, where it does not benefit the geese. If the eggs that roll out of the nest is picked up and taken away. The goose will keep moving her head as though pushing at an imaginary. Okay, the goose will try to push any shaped object such as a goal ball if it is placed near the nest. In fact, she will even carry out the retrieval pattern in response to much larger objects such as volleyball. This example illustrates the fixed aspect of fixed action pattern. Okay, in the greater majority of cases, the goose is likely to encounter in nature. The behavior of rolling any egg-like object near the nest back into the nest will be beneficial. However, it is a simply a biological program that runs in response to stimuli and can have unhelpful result under the unusual circumstances. Okay, through this, we have checked another case study of the male stickleback, which is another classical example of the fixed action patterns comes from the three-spine stickleback, a small freshwater fish. During the breeding season, male stickleback develop a red belly and display innate aggressive behavior toward the other males. When a male stickleback spot another nearby male, he will launch into a fixed action pattern involving aggressive display and designing on the scale of the stranger. The specific stimuli that trigger this fixed action pattern is a red belly coloration pattern characteristic of a male during the breeding season. How do we know that this is the trigger? If we check in the lab, or the researcher were check this trick in the lab, we have to expose this male fish to object that were painted with the red on their lower hull, but didn't otherwise look like the fish as shown in the figure. The male stickleback respond aggressively to the object just as they were the male stickleback. In contrast, no response was triggered by lifelike male stickleback model that were pointed white. Okay, so based on this example, this fixed action pattern has even been triggered by a fire trunk driving past a male stickleback stand. Okay, so how do we know if the behavior is innate, or how do we know this behavior is innate? So by the definition of the innate behavior, that is, it is a stereotype behavior, and we can see it as a genetically hardwired behavior or genetically inbuilt behavior in an organism rather than learning. But how do biologists figure out if a behavior is innate? To prove this, in general, scientists tested whether a behavior is innate by seeing whether it is performed correctly by the animals. That an animal that have not had a chance to learn the behavior by experiences. This might involve raising of the young animals separate from the adults or without the stimuli that trigger the behavior. As an example, let's consider the digging behavior in the deer mouse and beach mouse. Okay, so these species are closely related and can interbreed, but they live in different natural environment and have different burrowing digging behavior. The deer mouse dig a small short burrow, while beach mouse dig a long burrow with escape tunnel or a back door to get away from the predators. So is this difference in the burrow digging innate? To ask this question, researcher raised mice to both species in the lab with no exposure to the sand and opportunity to burrow. Then they provide them with sand, a clue for the burrow constructions. The given sand, each nine mouse dug exactly the type of the burrow made by its species in the wild. That is, Beach mice dug a long burrow with an escape tunnel, while deer mice burrow a short burrow without an escape tunnel. The ability of the mice to construct their normal tunnel without ever having such seen such a tunnel before show that the burrowing behavior was indeed innate. So, how is this behavior genetically controlled? That is the question. The researchers were again curious about the genetic basis of the aspect of the tunnel digging behavior of these mice. So, they have took an investigation a step further by crossing deer mouse with the beach mouse. Okay, so all of the hybrid mice dug burrow that were similar to the beach mouse tunnel and further an escape tunnel. In other words, escape tunnel digging is a dominant genetic trait using additional genetic test. The researcher found that this behavior trait may be largely controlled by a single gene. Okay, so this is all about the behavior, innate type of the behavior. Now, so dear friend, we will move toward our another type of the behavior, that is the learned behavior shown by the animal. It may be habituation, imprinting, classical conditioning or operant conditioning, or it may be a consecutive learning. Okay, so habituation is a simple learned behavior in which an animal gradually stops responding to the repeated stimuli. While imprinting is a specialized form of learning that occurs during a brief period of an young animal. That is duck imprinting on their mother. Okay. In classical conditioning, a new stimuli is associated with the pre-existing response. Through a repeated pairing of a new and previous known stimuli. In operant conditioning, an animal learns to perform a behavior more or less frequently through a reward or punishment that follows the behavior. Some animals, especially primates, are capable of more complex form of learning such as problem solving and construction of the mental maps. So friend, if you own a dog or have a friend who own a dog, you probably know that dog can be trained to do things like sit, bait, roll over and play it. These are the example of learned behavior, and dog can be capable of significant learning. By some estimates, a very clever dog has cognitive ability on par with the 2.5-year-old human. So in general, a learned behavior is one that an organism develops as a result of experience. Learned behavior contrasts with innate behavior, which are genetically hardwired and can be performed without any prior experience or training. Of course, some behavior of both learned and innate elements, zebra fish, are, as we seen in the previously example, are genetically programmed to learn a song, but song they sing depends on what they hear from their father. In this video lecture, we will take a look at the same example of the learned behavior in animal. We will start with the simple one like habituation and imprinting, and then we work away up to the complex cases like operant conditioning and consecutive learning. Okay, now learned behavior, even though they may have innate component or underpinning, allow an individual organism to adapt the change in the environment. learned behaviors are modified by the previous experience. Examples of simple learned behavior include habituation and de-imprinting. So these are the simplest learned behavior, that is the habituation and the imprinting. So we will move toward the first simplest example of the learned behavior, that is the habituation. Now what do you mean by habituation, or what we can say a habituation? Habituation is nothing but it is a simple form of learning in which an animal stops responding to a stimuli or a clue after a period of repeated exposure. This is a form of a non-associated learning, meaning that the stimuli is not likely that any punishment or reward. For example, pairing dogs typically sound an alarm call when threatened by a predator. At the first, they will give this alarm call in response to hearing human steps, which indicate the presence of a large and potential hungry animals. So, however, this pairless dog gradually become habituated to the sound of the human footstep as they repeatedly experience the sound without anything bad happening. Eventually, they stop giving an alarm call in response to the footstep. In this example, habituation is specific to that sound of the human footstep, as the animal still responding to the sound of the potential predators. Okay, so this is the simplest type of the behavior, that is a habituation, that pairless dogs were habituated with the same kind of the stimuli. Now another type of the simplest type of the learned behavior, that is the imprinting, which is a simple and highly specific type of learning that occurs at a particular age of life, that during the development of certain animal such as duck and geese. When the duckling hatches, they imprint on the first adult animal they see, typically their mothers. Once a duckling has imprint on its mother, the sight of the mother act as a clue to trigger a suit of the survival of promoting behavior, such as following the mother around and imitating her. Okay, so how do we know that this is not an innate behavior, in which a duckling is hardwired to follow around a female duck? That is, how do we No, imprinting is a learned process, conditioning by experience. If newborn duck or geese see the human before they see their mother, they will imprint on the human and follow it around just as they would follow their real mother. Okay, so an interesting case of imprinting being used for a good comes from the efforts of rehabilitating the endangered whooping crane by raising chicks in captivity. Biologists dress up a full whooping crane costume while caring for their young birds, ensuring that they don't imprint on the human but rather on the bird dummies that are a part of the customs. Eventually, they teach the bird to migrate using an ultraviolet aircraft, preparing them for a release into the wild. So this is the how imprinting work, or imprinting on the basis of this we can say that the imprinting is only a learned behavior and not a inborn, or we can say it as a stereotype of behavior. Different. Now we move toward the another kind of complex type of behavior that shown by the animal, that is conditioned behavior, are the result of associate learning, which takes two forms, that is the classical conditioning and operant conditioning. So the classical conditioning associated with one stimuli which is associated with the second stimuli to which it had no previous connection. The most famous example of classical conditioning comes from the Ivan Pavlov's experiment, in which dogs were conditioned to drool in response to a previous associated with the food upon hearing a sound of bell. As Pavlov observed, and as you may have noticed, to dogs salivate or drool in response to a sight or smell of the food. This is something dogs do innately without any need for learning. In the language of classical conditioning, these existing stimuli responses pair can be broken into a unconditioning stimuli. The sight of smell of the food and the unconditional response drooling. Okay, so in Pavlov's experiment, every time a dog was given food, another stimuli was provided alongside the unconditional stimuli. Specifically, a bell was rung at the same time and the dog received food. This ringing of bell paired with the food is an example of conditioning stimuli, a new stimuli delivered in parallel with the unconditional stimuli. So okay, so over the time the dog learned to associate the learning of the bell with the food and to respond to drooling. Eventually, they would respond with the drool when the bell was rung, even when the unconditional stimuli. The food was upset. This new artificial form of stimuli response pair consists of conditioning stimuli and the bell ringing and conditional response drooling. So, is the unconditional response drooling in response to a food exactly identical to the conditional response drooling in response to the bell? It is not necessary. Pavlov discovered that the saliva in conditional dog was actually different in composition than the saliva of the unconditioned dog. Okay, so how this conditioning behaviors work in the dog? That is the one of the complex type of the learned behavior that's shown in the animals. Now, another type of the learned behavior, that is the afferent conditioning, which is a bit different than the classical conditioning in that it does not rarely on an existing stimuli response pair. Wherever an organism performs a behavior or an intermediate step on the way to the complete behavior, it is given a reward for or a punishment. At the first, the organism may perform the behavior, for example, the pressing lever purely by chance, in case of the rat experiment. Though the reinforcement of the organism is induced to perform the behavior more or less frequently. One of the prominent early investigators of the afferent conditioning was the psychologist B.F. Skinner, and the inventor of the Skinner box, as shown in the image. Skinner put rat in box containing a lever that would be dispense food when pushed by the rat. The rat would initially push the lever a few times by accident and would then begin to associate it pushing the lever with the getting the food. Okay. Over the time, the rat would push the lever more and more frequently in order to obtain the food. Okay, so not all the sneaker experiments were involved the pleasant treat or the reward. The bottom of the box consists of a metal grid that could deliver an electric shock to the rat, and as a punishment, when the rat got an electric shock each time it performed a certain behavior in a quick Yes, it performs a certain behavior and it quickly learned to stop performing the behavior. As this example shows, both positive and negative reinforcement can be used to shape an organism behavior in operant conditioning. Right? So it is about the whole everything about the poor rat. Okay. So the operant conditioning is the basis of most animal training. For you might give your dog a biscuit or a good dog as a compliment every time it shit, roll over, or reframe from the barking. On the other hand, cow in the field surrounded by electric fence will quickly learn to avoid the brushing of the against the fence. As this example illustrated, operant conditioning through the reinforcement can cause animal to engage in a behavior they would not have eventually performed, or to avoid the behavior that are normally part of their repertoires. Okay, so this is about everything about the operant conditioning that shown by the rat in the sneaker box, or by the cow. Okay, so now we will move toward the learning and cognition. The human and other primate and some non-primate animals are capable of sophisticated learning that does not fit under the heading of the classical or operational conditioning. And so we will have some example of problem solving and the complex spatial learning of the non-human animals. Right, so the problem solving in chimpanzee is an example for the learning and cognition. The German scientist Wolfgang Kohler did some of the earlier study on problem solving in chimpanzee. He found that the chimpanzee were capable of abstract through and could think their way through the possible solution to a puzzle. Amazingly, the result of solution even before they carried it out. So in Kohler experiment, Kohler hang a banana in the chimpanzee cage too high for them to reach. Several boxes were also placed randomly on the floor. And faced with this dilemma, some of the chimpanzee, after a few falls started and some fractions, stacked the boxes on the one top the other, climbing on the top of them and getting the banana. This behavior suggests they could visualize the result of stacking the boxes before they actually carried out this action. So learning that extends beyond the simple associate is not limited to the primate. Maze running experiment done in 1920 may show in the photographs where demonstrated the rat were capable of complex spatial learning. So in this experiment, the rat were divided into three groups. Group first, rat got food at the end of the maze for day one. Group second, rat were placed in the maze 1-6 consecutive days before receiving the food at the end of the maze. And the group third, the rat were placed in the maze for the 3 consecutive days before receiving food at the end of the maze. So not surprisingly, rat given the food reward for day one appeared to be learn faster and had more rapid drop in their number of errors while running the maze than the rat not given an initial reward. So what was the most striking, however, what was the happened after the group second and group third rat were given the food? In both the group, The day after the food had been provided, the rat showed up a sharp drop in the number of ear, almost catching up the group first rat. And this pattern suggests that the group second and group third rat had been learning efficiently and building a mental map in the previous day. They just didn't have much reason to demonstrate their learning until the food showed. Okay, and these results show that rats are capable of the complex spatial learning, even in the absence of direct reward, in other words, without reinforcement. Lateral experiment confirmed that the rat make a representation of the maze in their mind, a consecutive map, rather than a simple learning or a conditional series of the term. Okay, so this is all about the innate behavior, this is all about the learned behavior and their type. And dear friend, today we have learned about the different types of the behavior. So in our next video lecture, we will learn about the animal communications. So if you like this video lecture, please don't forget to like and subscribe to the my YouTube channel and press bell icon for more update about the my video. Thank you very much.